Technology has the potential to redefine classroom assessment, from substituting paper with digital assessments to new assessments we haven't even imagined yet. While we don't want to rely on technology too much, it can help us transform the way we assess students by diversifying our tools, enhancing the feedback process, engaging our students, providing insight into student performance, and more.
If there are ways to differentiate assessment to accommodate a diverse array of learners, could technology help make that happen? How can we expand the opportunity for student success while maintaining an assessment's validity? The key here is to consider what is truly being assessed and what flexibility in assessment we may have. What knowledge, skills, or abilities do we want to assess? And how does technology influence student performance? Let's say students do a timed writing assignment in class. A student's typing speed will have significant influence on the amount of writing they can produce. In this case, the use of a keyboard might interfere with the construct we're trying to measure, writing ability. If we're more interested in testing their ability to develop an argument rather than timed writing, could they record a podcast? Can I give them a choice in how they want to be assessed? This concept of accommodating the needs and abilities of all learners is called Universal Design for Learning, or UDL. UDL supports a shift from traditional classrooms to classrooms that broaden the range of content, teaching methods, and assessments to optimize chances of success for all kinds of learners. If we think of diversifying assessments within the SAMR model, we can see how technology can transform them into something new. When I taught an introductory college writing course for ESL students, I always used the first draft, second draft, and final draft approach. Students would write their essays using an online word processor, then submit their drafts to our learning management system. I'd grade the assignments or return them to students via email. In this case, our approach was completely based on pen and paper models of teaching and learning. I just substituted paper with a word processor and wasn't fully taking advantage of the affordances of online word processing apps like Word Online or Google Docs to redefine the process. But in the spirit of using technology to redefine assessment, the next time I taught my class, the students shared their living documents with me throughout the writing process. Through revision history and track changes, I could at any time check on the progress of their work. No more drafts. Version history was able to show me how much students wrote, when they wrote, and whether they incorporated my suggestions into their work. And they could use the comments feature to ask me questions or seek help about their work. The task was thus transformed from a more traditional feedback loop to one that is more timely, transparent, and ongoing. There are two important types of data that can be used to improve language teaching and assessment. The first is data related to individual students' progress, which can be used to provide personalized feedback. The second set of data provides key indicators to instructors on overall student performance. This can provide valuable insight on students' learning progress that can be used to modify instruction as needed. Beyond providing the teacher with data they can use to adjust instruction, tech tools can also provide students with immediate personalized feedback. With online quiz software, for example, students can see how they did right away and ask questions on any areas they may be confused on. This also gives educators a chance to immediately see overall class performance and provide students more agency in their learning process and can help motivate them.
This is particularly helpful in large classes where I don't always have the time to provide as much individualized support to each student as I would like. One of the things I spend a lot of time doing is providing feedback on students' grammar, spelling, and mechanics. Instead, what if I have students work with an AI-based program to refine their writing? Grammarly and Conmigo are specifically designed to provide this type of support. And students can also input their work into general use AI chatbots, such as ChatGPT and Perplexity, to receive feedback. In working with these chatbots, I recommend students add no more than a single paragraph at a time and use a prompt that asks for specific recommendations to improve the writing instead of letting the chatbot simply rewrite it, which tends to be the default. Because the feedback process occurs between the student and the chatbot, One drawback is that the instructor may not get an idea for what common issues students are having. However, research findings so far have shown that Gen AI is able to provide helpful personalized support in areas such as grammar, mechanics, and vocabulary. By automating some aspects of this process, I can focus my feedback on things that Gen AI is not yet able to do well, such as critical thinking, and it gives me more time to create meaningful and engaging learning experiences.
When the growth of AI began to accelerate, a first conversation among educators was how it would be used by students to write papers. However, early research suggests for now, we're not seeing a significant uptick in cheating behaviors, but that students who were prone to cheating are adding a new tool to their toolkit. Another factor that complicates the hunt for AI-generated work is the inaccuracy of AI plagiarism detectors and the ability for them to be gamed. A learner could have AI generate an essay for them and then feed it back into an AI software with a prompt to add more lexical and syntactic complexity to make them harder to identify as AI generated. One way around this challenge is to tilt your assignments. Transparency in Learning and Teaching, or TILT, recommends that prior to assignments, educators clearly define and communicate to students the purpose of an assignment and what skills will be practiced. Clearly explain what steps students should take and what criteria they need to meet to be successful via a rubric or a checklist. The more clearly defined and transparent our assignments are, the less likely students will be to turn to assistive tools like AI software for help.
Instead of focusing our efforts on trying to catch students using Gen AI, we can consider building assessments so students either don't feel a need to use it or learn how to harness it to support their learning. One scale we can use is the AI assessment scale. At the most basic level, students do not use AI. As we move through the scale, students use AI as a study tool to review course content, for idea generation to stimulate brainstorming, for editing, similar to a writing tutor, to generate output for part of a task, which students would evaluate. And finally, AI might be integrated in full without restrictions as a creative partner, allowing students to focus more on critical thinking and problem solving. One thing to note is that at no point in this scale is AI doing 100% of the work. Instead, AI is shifting its role, and students are being asked to use different skills at each level. One thing I like to do with my intermediate level students is have them write the end of a cartoon story to practice prediction. The assignment starts with giving students the first 6 frames of a cartoon. Students then finish the story and typically draw their own pictures, something some students struggle with. With the AI assessment scale in mind, I could have them use Gen AI, such as Midjourney or Leonardo, to generate images instead of drawing cartoons themselves. In asking AI to generate the pictures, the students can focus their time and effort on predictions, which is the objective of the assignment. As an added bonus, they get feedback about how clearly they describe their ideas to the image generator. By specifying how students could use AI and focusing on process rather than product, instructors can build assessments that guide students in becoming more critical, informed users.
When it comes to assessment, we first need a clear understanding of what we are trying to assess before we choose appropriate technology. We should rethink how technology can help us transform and diversify the way we do assessment and how it can provide insight into our students' performance. And to address concerns about plagiarism, educators can be more intentional about including where and how students may use AI in their work.